Well, hello. First words I've actually spoken out loud all day. Such is my lonely existence. This is just a trial version. I don't know if this is going to be the one. I did bring down a beer. I hope it's not going to explode. It didn't explode. Thank goodness. Yes, I do drink. This is one of the home brews I've made myself. It's probably about the fifth time around this bottle's been through, if not more. It feels terrible to be in this situation. Feels really terrible. So I don't know where to begin. Where to begin? I could tell my whole life story. I could wax on about this and wax off about that, but the fact of the matter is, I've come to the end of a decent, reasonable existence. Can I say? I am basically a philosopher. That's what I've been my whole life. When I first moved up to Byron Bay when I was 20 years old with my partner who just dropped out of nursing because she couldn't handle putting injections into people. And she said, let's go to Byron. I said, okay, let's do it. So we moved up in our combi. We managed to find a unit after a couple of weeks. We lived in that at $150 a week. And then to save money, we managed to get a loan because we were both, you know, earning just enough to get a loan to buy a caravan, which we could then put into a caravan park and only pay $50 a week rent. And so we were doing quite well for ourselves. And after a couple more years, I decided to bite the bullet and I decided to ask her to marry me. Probably wasn't the smartest thing to do, but it seemed to be the right thing to do. And probably the last time I saw many of you, of my favourite relatives, on both sides of the family. I love my family. Don't get me wrong. And it wasn't the last time. Maybe I've seen you half a dozen times ever since. It's going back a fair while now. Anyway, I'm trying to try to keep this as short as possible, and it's not going to be easy. We got married. We had a 2-week honeymoon, thanks to the generosity of you, all you guys. You threw in quite a nice, generous sum as a wedding gift to us. And I'd never had a 2-week holiday before. We went to a resort. It was South Stradbroke, one of the cheapest resorts you can imagine in Australia, but it was good. We got free lunch every day, a free bottle of champagne on arrival. That's the highlight of my life. A 2-week holiday when I got married. Yeah. Pretty pathetic, huh? Anyway, when we got back, went back to doing what I did, cleaning pubs. She went back to what she was doing, working in nursing homes. Both of us casual employees, doing what we had to do. And anyway, 10 months later, along came our first little ball of joy, little Jessica. She was the first great-granddaughter on both sides of the family, Thatcher and the Labour side. Unfortunately, within days of hearing the news, dear old granddad, Elmo, Claude Elmo, he passed away. It was expected in a way, but still. I think he knew in a way that the line was carrying on. And so he was able to move on. Oh man, I didn't think this would affect me so emotionally. Something I've sort of held up inside all these years, because I was unable to get to his funeral and say goodbye. Man, I love that guy. Eating the carrots out of his patch and tomatoes off the vine. Using his water tank as a swimming pool. Wow. I really never expected I'd get that emotional. Memories. Remember when Grandpa died? I was only 5 years old, and I think they were just distracting me in the church for his funeral service. So I don't have that many memories of Grandpa, my dad's dad. But the ones I do have, yeah, he was a really good man. Someone who took on some of the harshest bit of land that he could find and decided to make a go of it. Raised 5 kids very successfully. And can you believe it? The wife he chose. My dear Nana, the great granny to my children, is still alive. And I think that's awesome. That is awesome. 102 years old and still going. And your birthday is just the day after Jessica's, my first year, my first child. Sorry, I'm getting a bit emotional because there's so many memories and everything I could talk about. And this could take me all night talking about it. But anyway, when Jessica turned 2, it was the very day I bought my first business. I was still working in the pub at 4 a.m. in the morning, cleaning the guts out of this most filthy, disgusting pub in Byron Bay that you can imagine. Vomit and glass. You don't want to know the details. And Kim was still working in the nursing home, which she soon had to give away because we had a business now. It took the two of us to run it. We bought this closing down pet shop business. We got it for next to nothing, 10 grand, thanks to a bit of help from my parents again and extending out a credit card and doing everything we possibly could to get this opportunity. And we built up a really good business over the next 7 years that we had it for. I knew I could do it. If I'm given an opportunity, I'll take care of it and make sure I make the best of it. Every year we had that business, we turned over 50 grand more than the year before. That's how hard I worked at it. I worked and worked and worked. And after 4 years, I was actually able to give away the cleaning business where I was starting at 4 a.m. So, you know, I know hard work. I know striving hard to bring up children, to bust my gut, to get somewhere. But after that 7 year period, that's when Kim decided, well, it's such a successful business now, she can do it on her own, because we disagreed on so much stuff. I won't go into the details, but 9 months later, she sold it and she made a loss. So I got nothing out of all that hard years of work. Then she insisted on selling the family house that where I was able to share the kids 50-50 at least with her. No, but before I got the chance to do that, she moved the kids away, further away, so. Fortunately, the house had enough equity in that time. I was able to take out another loan, bought her out, and bought into a cleaning business. Back cleaning those pubs again, those very same pubs down in Byron. And the business was doing really well, but you know, I struggled. I wanted to keep the kids with me. By that stage, yeah, long story short, three of them. It was a successful business. Well, I had it for 5 years. I was making good money, and I probably could have taken better care of it, but all I was doing was paying the mortgage, looking after this new partner I'd got from New Zealand, her kids, plus my kids, plus, you know, just working, working, working 7 days a week. I don't think I'd ever really had a holiday ever since that honeymoon. Okay, I've had since. Let me think. Let me count them on one hand. I went to New Zealand once to meet the new partner who I'd found, which turned out to be much bigger than I imagined, but it's okay. I went there again for my mother's funeral, just to be there for family support. I've been to the Philippines since, because I'm not going to go into the long and detailed story of how I met the perfect woman for me, who she is perfect, a good heart, beautiful soul. And I went back to the Philippines a second time because I was dragged over there by a mate who insisted I had to go back over there so he could meet her cousin. And biggest, dumbest, stupidest thing I've ever did, because all it's done is left me with is debt, debt, and debt. And when I had this good cleaning business, okay, you might wonder where that went. Well, after about 5 years of that, the guy I bought it off, his younger brother, decided it was meant to have come to him in the first place. And so I was trying to negotiate selling it to him. And in the process of negotiating, we went out for a business lunch type of thing. And, I don't want to go into the details, but I've never been on drugs in my life. I've never been drugged before in my life, but holy shit, he drugged me something severe. And 5 days later, when I finally came to my senses and realized what had happened, I'd lost the business. It was all gone. He got it for nothing. I lost everything. I lost my house. I had to go back to work in minimum wage for whatever I could find and still do whatever I could to put Jack, my son, through high school the best way I could, which is why I'm living here in this house right now, which I cannot afford. So, okay, that's, I told you this is a rough version. I don't think this is gonna be the right one. But on my walk out tonight, looking at the stars, as I do every night with my dog, it reminded me of my childhood and how every birthday I would get a present from Nana, and her present was always a book. And the most favourite book I grew up with was one from Nana, Aesop's Fables. And the one that came to me tonight was this one where there was this man who spent his whole life looking at the stars, which is what I do as a philosopher. I look at the stars, I contemplate the stars, I contemplate everything. Yeah, I'm not taking good practical care of my life, I know. I should have gone and got a degree and become an engineer or an architect or a lawyer. I could be a lawyer. I don't think I'd be a good doctor because I don't like cutting people. Or injecting them. Even though that's what nurses do. I was going to be a naturopath, but one thing led to another in my life, and where I ended up here and now He's like the guy in the Aesop's fables who was looking at the stars all his life, and he spent so much time looking at the stars that one time he fell into a pit and it killed him. And that's where I am at the moment. I am in the pit and I can't get out. And I'm down here starving. I can't claw my way up. I can't get out. I need the love of family to build me a ladder to get me out of here. And don't get me wrong, I'm still going to look at the stars. I'm still going to live my humble, peaceful, walk my dog existence. But I have the opportunity at this moment to get onto a piece of land where it will be rent free as long as I can put some accommodation onto it. And it's not just accommodation that I need. I don't know if you can understand my existence that I've been for all these years, but I always invest in things as cheap as possible, secondhand and all the rest, junk basically, for ideas and concepts which I know what the world needs to be a better place. I know how crazy that might sound to some of you. You might think I'm just a nutter, a drunk. I'm not a drunk. Okay, I drink, but I'm not stupid. I keep my senses with me and I only drink as soon as I'm drunk. You know, that's me. I regret that. I don't like to ever get drunk. I drink for sobriety, if you can believe that. I know. My own home brews, I make them to a non-specific. I dabble with recipes all the time, but I always use really good ingredients, pure natural raw honey, health improving ingredients. As you can see, I'm not in a bad state of health, even though I might be starving and the rags I've been wearing for the last 10 years has slowly fallen off me. I'm still a very healthy and viable human being with many, many good ideas. And I know if I get the opportunity that I can do a lot of good for this world in ways that you still can't even imagine. Yes, okay, I waste a lot of time because sometimes when you feel so helpless, what did they say about Nero when Rome was burning? He fiddled. This is how I feel sometimes. My world is just falling apart, so I've got nothing left to do but pull my guitar out and play a few songs because I've got to enjoy my time while I've got it left because I don't feel I've got any time left. But in these last couple of weeks, I feel I've got opportunity to start a second life, a new life, a different life where I'm getting away from all this clutter, all these books that I've accumulated, and all this stuff where I think I can make money from a new business idea or something. I don't no longer need that because none of them work because no matter how you try, no matter how much you apply yourself to one particular idea, which I have really tried with the mattress sanitizing idea, which is going to be a brilliant idea once somebody really applies themselves to that, I just don't have the money to invest in the advertising, for example. It would be a great business, but I don't want to live in this mediocrity, this same cycle of pay and rent, paying electricity, paying everybody else to get rich off my hard work. All I want now is a simple existence, and I've been offered a simple existence where I can live on some land rent-free if I can provide my own accommodation, and I want to take as much of this good innovative stuff that I need while I keep getting rid of all the clutter. And yes, there is a lot of clutter, I will admit. I've always had a few grandiose ideas. I want to start again from the ground up, and rather than go and throw myself off a bridge with a bit of rope around my neck, which is what I've been so tempted to do in these last few months, I just want to get back up on my feet. I want to start again. And I know I can do it. And I know I can bring in some very innovative, great ideas and set an example for how people like myself can do it from next to nothing, with some I don't know, this block of land, it's a bare block of land and it's got a tiny little scum-ridden pond next to it, and I reckon I can turn that into a veritable paradise in a few short years if I can get enough decent accommodation and, you know, maybe a shipping container to store a heap of my tools and various things that I need. I know I can do it. And all I need is to be able to keep my vehicle on the road. I want to fix up. That one's not so bad, even though the back of it's rotten, but this one down here is so rotten. It doesn't present well because it gives me such bad breath. And it gives me a lot of pain. And then I've got another one up here, looking so bad. I don't want to get a big gap in my teeth. And I want to preserve my teeth. You know, I've got pretty good teeth for an Australian. I've been blessed with a lot of good things in my life. I've got a good heart. I care about animals, which is why I care about the people I've cared about in my past, because they care about animals as well. But what I care about is trying to stay alive. And it was just a month ago I decided, well, the best thing to do for someone in my position was to not stay alive. Dumb decision, I know. I want to stay alive. I really do. But I can't. I'm down in this pit. I'm down. I cannot survive for 2 more weeks. And I know. That's probably the dumbest thing to say when you're asking for charity. I know. I can make a good go of this. I'm only 45. I want to live to at least 90. I think I can. I know I can, but I can't do it without this second chance. So I beg you from the bottom of my heart, please, please give me this chance. Give me this chance and I will prove to you how much value I still have left to give in this life. I know you're all good people, both sides of my family. Thatchers, Laborses. You're all such good, good people. And I know you're all very, very conservative, which is probably what I haven't been most of my life, because when I have love in my heart, I give. You know, for the last few years, yes, I do have the most beautiful, not just beautiful, but beautiful in her heart, the most lovely Filipino. I know what you're thinking straight away, automatically, everybody does it. Ah, scammer, bloody. All those. No, she is a genuine, the woman I've been searching for my whole life. and I would do anything for her. But I can't do anything for her unless I get back in my life. And then maybe I might have a chance of bringing her over here, as I intended to do all this time, 4.5 years ago. Yeah, well, that's probably put you all off now, hasn't it? Oh, you just after it. No. You've all found the woman you love because you found them from convenience. I searched the world over and I found her. Not because of any sort of convenience or suitability or availability or anything like that. I searched and searched and searched before I found her. And she has a heart of gold. And I have a heart of gold. And maybe someday, 5 years more down the track, after I get my life back together, I might be able to start sending her $50 a week again so she can feed her family, her old dying parents. Yeah, I messed this one up fully by mentioning her, didn't I? Because I have compassion for people in third world countries. Makes me... Now, every time I talk to family, you've been sending money to the Philippines, but you're so desperate here? Yeah. They're way more desperate than me. So, after I've paid my rent, put fuel in my car and bought $30 worth of food for the week, if I've got $50 left over, which I was able to do 6 months ago, haven't been able to do it since then, since my wages are cut, yeah, I would. It's what you do when you love somebody and you care for them. And you know they're genuine, and you know that they would be your good wife. Okay, good thing this is a rough draft, because I'm just definitely going to have to make another one. This time I'm going to leave out everything about I care for with all my heart and soul, because I'm not going to take second best. Yeah, I'll live on the streets if I could get the dollar, and I'd still send her any little bit I could, because I know in my heart she's genuine. I've seen her family. I've seen the way they live. I've seen the way they're not scammers. They're genuine people doing it tough. And since this flood that they just had 2 weeks ago, now they got nothing. Everything got ruined. All the beds, all the clothing, everything they had. Can you imagine if your whole house just went waist deep in water? And you couldn't, you know, you might have saved the most essential thing. You might have picked your refrigerator up and put it up as high as possible, but that's about all they could save. It just sickens me. Now they're sleeping on floors. Muddy floors at that, too. Waiting for the rain to stop so they can do a proper clean out. So of course I have compassion. This is the woman who was going to genuinely be my wife for the rest of my life. I know every single one of you, you've heard the same story. Oh yeah, we've heard that before. Blah, blah. Well, I'm not that stupid, okay? I'm not stupid. I did my research. I did my due diligence. And I trusted my instincts. So, if you have no compassion in your heart, simply because you don't trust my judgment, then fine, let me hang. But I trust you know me better than that, because you know I am a Thatcher and I am a Labus, and I'm a true person with true diligence, great instinct, huge intelligence, a bit of love for the drink. Can't deny that. But I deserve to live. Philosophers don't get paid for what they do, but I have so much to give, so much to give to all humanity. And I pray that you help me keep me alive in the most humble way possible. I need a minimum of 20,000. I know they should say you should ask for less, but 20,000 is just enough for me to set up a decent cabin, set up some supplies to start growing the aquaponics at the most humble level possible, get rid of all the stuff I've got to get rid of. That's going to cost a lot of money. I can sell a lot of it, but most of it's just I can't keep my car on the road. I can't even survive week to week. I'm sick of living week to week. What I need is a big boost so I can get out of this rut, out of it forever. I can still keep a bit of income coming in from the same rut that I'm in at the moment, but at least I'm not going to be paying $400 a week in rent just to live in a freaking house. I can get out of that. And if you really insist, we can work out a decent loan. Look, 50,000 bucks would be enough